Okay, welcome to lecture number one, welcome to lecture number three on sets and functions. So under this lecture, we are going to concentrate on functions. So like I said earlier, due to power, so I couldn't continue. So we talked about what a mapping or a function is, where we said a function set A to a set B a function from a set A to a set B is a rule which assigns to every member X of A unique determined member Y of B, and we denote this rule by this symbol, where F, this what here we mean here is that the function F maps the elements, the set A onto the set B. Then again, we mentioned say the element A, mean the element Y, which belongs to the set B, this element which corresponds to the given X, which is in set A, is denoted by F of X. And this F of X is called the image of X under F. Now, again, I mentioned to say, if for the function F which maps the set A onto the set A is called the domain, and the set B is called the range or codomain of the function. And we mentioned to say, the range of the function we denoted by F of A, which is equal to this set contains all the elements F of X which belongs to B that you had found by acting the function on an element X in A. That's what we mentioned. And again, I also mentioned about this situation where if we have a set X which is a subset of a set A, then the image of the set X under the function is defined as F of X, capital X, is equal to the set containing all the elements F of X in B, such that this small X is in the capital set X. Okay, again, I also mentioned something to do with the inverse of a function. You know, what the inverse of a function does is, whatever the function does, the inverse function decides to redo, like redoing the process, like it reverses, it decides to reverse. Or let me just say undo, yes. Whatever the function does, the inverse of the function undoes the process. So what we have is, if we have a function from a set A to a set B, and if Y is an element of a set B, and there is an element X which is in the set A, such that this element in BY is equal to F of X, such that this element Y which is in the set B, you obtained it by acting the function onto an element X, then this element X is called the inverse image or pre-image of Y. If I start with Y, I'm going to say the element Y is an image of X. But if I start with X, I'll say the element X is the pre-image or the inverse image of Y. And we write this as X is equal to the inverse function of an element X. This is, and again, I mentioned to say, if we have a subset Y, which is a subset of B, then the inverse image or pre-image of this subset Y of B under the function F, which is defined from a set A to a set B, is given by F inverse of the set Y will contain this set, will contain all those elements X which are found in the set A, where f of x is in the set y. Okay, so this is where we then now we're supposed to look at also other things, other ways on how we can other properties that involves functions. Now maybe before we go further, let's look at if we can recall now to each mapping f. Now if you have this mapping f which is on a set A and B, there corresponds the subset. You see, you remember when we defined a relation, we said a relation is a subset of the Cartesian, the relation is a subset of the Cartesian product of two sets. Now, let's look at how you define the elements of a function that acts on this element and the other elements. So, if you look at the elements that we usually found, you pick an element in set A, you substitute it into the function, what you're going to get is an element in set B. So, if you want to write the set of in that manner, this is a set of ordered pairs. This is a set of ordered pairs. So, this type of a set, it gives us what we call a graph. So, in short, a graph of a function is the Cartesian product of two sets, the domain of the function and the range of the function. So the elements that we get, we usually read them as x, y. We get them in as a set of ordered pairs. So this set of ordered pairs is the one that we've written here. A times the set B, it will contain a set of ordered pairs x and comma f of x, such that this x is found in A. This set is the one that we call the graph of a function. The graph of a function. Now, let's look at some types of functions. When we call a given function to be a constant function? Now, let the sets A and B be arbitrary non-empty sets. Then a function f from a set A to a set B is called a constant function if for some k which is in B, f of x is always equal to that k. Whatever value that you pick from the set B, if this function acts on any of the values which are in set B, the answer that you get is the same constant, is the constant k in B. So you pick some values, you pick these objects, the x in any value x in A, and then this function acts on it, what you get is the k, it's the same value, which is the k, which is found in B. So then we call this function a constant function. Now, if you look at the constant function, its range, hence the range of a function f, is a singleton set. The range, because you, for example, you pick a value in set A, you pick this value in set A, the function acts on it, you get k. You pick another value, this function acts on it, it will be the same k. You pick another, so it's like the range, it's going to be a singleton set containing the constant k. That will be the range of the given function. Now, when do we call two functions to be equal? So, two functions or mappings, f that maps the elements of A onto the elements of B, and also the function g, which maps the elements of A onto the elements of B, are said to be equal, which we write as f is equal to b, if f of x is equal to g of x. So, whichever value that you pick, whichever value of x that you pick in A, when you substitute it, when this function f of x acts on it, the answer that you get, the answer that you find in B, is the same as when the function g of x acts on that same value x that you pick in set A. Then we say the two functions are equal. Now, If you look at this question on equality of functions, there some of you maybe you look at it from this point to say, because F is acting on its acting maps, because F maps elements of set A to elements of set B, and G maps elements of set A to elements of set B, then automatically these two functions are the same. No, that's not the case. You can have functions acting on the same domain and then taking elements into the same range, but you find that the way they act on the elements that you pick is different. So here, you can only call them to be equal if whenever you pick an element from the set A, and then these two functions act on that element, they produce the same result. Then you're going to say these two sets are equal. So in this scenario, in other ways, we usually say two functions are equal if they have the same graph. They have the same graph. Now, we have talked about equal functions. We have talked about inverse of a function. We have also talked about the Cartesian product, the graph of a function. Now, let's come to the next point here, where we are going to talk about the one-to-one functions, which you call as, we are also going to talk about the onto functions and into functions. Now, let's start with definition number 5. A function f that maps elements of set A onto elements of set B is said to be into C. A function, this function f, is mapping elements of set A to elements of set B. This function, we call it an into function if f of A is a proper subset of B. If wherever the function acts on an element of a set A, that function, this f of A, is a subset of a set B. Then we call it into. Now, proper, we know what we mean by proper. In short, what we're saying is, when this function acts on an element, all the elements of set A, the final resulting set is a subset of set B, is a proper subset. You know, whenever this function f acts on an element, it produces an image. It acts on another element, it produces an image. So what we're saying is, when all the elements in set A are exhausted, where this function has acted on every element in set A, and you have produced the resulting elements, then when you form a set of those resulting elements, that set that you have formed of the Y's, you've discovered that it is a subset of a set B. Then we say this function is into. Now, this function is onto or surjective if f of x is equal to b. What we mean here, for every x in A, or if the range of f is equal to the set B. What do we mean here? Here, what we mean is, you know, you pick all the elements in set A, and then this function acts on those elements, you produce the y values. Now, after producing these y values, you discover that if we form a set of those y values, that set is equal to the set B itself. Then we are going to say this function is an onto or surjection function. Now, when do we call it definition number 6? When can we call a function to be a one-to-one or an injective function? So a function f which acts on elements, which maps the element of set A to the elements of set B, is said to be one-to-one or injective if whenever for every distinct element. So in this case, whenever you have two elements, A1 and A2 in set B, which are different from each other, whenever you have two elements, A1 and A2 in set A, which are different from each other, then F of the element A is not equal to F of the element A2. So F of A1 is not equal to F of A2 in B. Remember, F of A1 is an element of B, F of A2 is an element of B. But this, provided A1 and A2 are different, then the resulting value of F of A1 and F of A2 will also be different. If they are the same, then the resulting value will also be the same. Thus, distinct elements have distinct values. The remark number one is just trying to tell us the other form on how we can define a one-to-one function. Or rather, when you are constructing a proof to show that a given function is one-to-one, then the only thing that you need to show is that. You need to show that if f of a1 is equal to f of a2, then a1 is equal to a2. So basically, an equivalent formulation often used to prove or to show that a given function is one-to-one is to show that this function is one-to-one if and only if whenever f of a1 is equal to f of a2, then a1 is equal to a2. Then you're going to say the given function is one-to-one. What is so important about one-to-one function? These one-to-one functions are so very much important because we can use them to define and to determine the inverse of a function. We can use them to define the inverse of a function. Remember, a function has an inverse if it is a one-to-one function. If a function is not a one-to-one function, then that function will not have an inverse. That's the most important part about the one-to-one function. We can go forward and reverse the process. Now, let's look at definition number 7. If we have a function f that is mapping the elements of A onto two elements of set B, if this is a one-to-one function, then we define the function F inverse that maps the element of F of A. So in short, the elements which are in B, F of A is a subset of B. So that maps the element of the subset of B, which is F of A, onto A, which is read as F inverse as follows. This one, we read it as for every Y, which is equal to F of A, define F inverse of Y to be the unique preimage of Y under F. In this case now, we write F inverse of Y is equal to X if and only if F of X is equal to Y. So in short, the F inverse of Y is equal to X provided F of X is equal to Y. Now, if you look at from this definition number 7, I think we are able to see that the F inverse of a function, the inverse of a function is an onto, F inverse is onto A. In short, the inverse of a function is an onto function, and F inverse is a one-to-one function. The inverse of a function is a one-to-one function. Because if you have a function f which is one-to-one, then its inverse is also one-to-one. Reason being, you have this function which is one-to-one that you can find its inverse. Now, if you are able to find its inverse, you can reverse its inverse. Now, to reverse the inverse of a function, it should be also be one-to-one. That makes it to be a one-to-one function. Now, let's look at another property which involves we call bijection. So when is a function said to be a bijective function? So a function f that maps elements of set A to elements of set B is said to be an equivalence or a bijective, or in short we say a bijection, if f is both injective and surjective. What do we mean here? So in short, a function is said to be a bijective function If a function, this function is both injective and surjective. It's both injective. What we mean by being injective, it's both one-to-one and onto. Then we call that function to be a bijective function. Now, definition number 9 is talking about an identity function. How does an identity function behave when it acts on an element of a given set? So, for any set A, if you have any set A, the function id subscript A, so id means id subscript A, that maps elements of set A onto elements of set A. In short, it maps elements of set A onto itself, which is defined by IDA of X is equal to X for every X in A is called an identity function on A. So what this function does is, it maps the elements of set A onto themselves. Like you map the element X onto X, you map this next element onto itself. So this function is called an identity function. So the identity function maps each element of X onto itself. Now, if you look at how this definition for the identity function has been defined, we can easily see that the identity function is a one-to-one function and onto A. Why is it a one-to-one function? Because you pick an element, for example, you have this set containing elements 1, 2, 3. You pick an element 1, it maps it onto 1. You pick an element 2, it maps it onto 2. You pick the element 3, it maps it onto 3. No diverging. So from the look of things, from that perspective, this function is one-to-one. And it's also onto A. It's a one-to-one function, which is also an onto function. In that scenario, because of it being a one-to-one function, then it has an identity. I mean, it has an inverse. Because it's a one, the identity function is a one-to-one function, then it has got an inverse. This inverse again acts on the elements of A, because you pick elements of set A, you substitute them to the identity function. What you get is the same elements in set A. So each inverse again acts on the elements of set A. It produces again the elements in set A, corresponding elements in set A. So that's what the identity function, that's how the identity function behaves when it acts on elements of a given set. Okay, now, the composition of functions. The composition of functions. I think some of these concepts, we already did them in first year under functions. When we looked at functions, we looked at how we can combine functions, and the composition of functions is one of them. I remember you looked at addition, you can add functions to produce another function, you can subtract, you can divide, you can multiply. And then one of the other special combination of functions is the composition of functions. Now, if we have a function f, we have a function f that maps elements of set A onto elements of set B. If this is a function from set A to set B, and G is a function from B, set B to set C, then the composition of G by F, which we denote as G site F or G of F or GOF, is the function defined by G of F of X. This is equal to the same as G of F of X for all X which are found in a set A. Now, generally, the composition G of F is not necessarily equal to F of G. The composition GOF is not necessarily equal to F of G. This can only be equal under special cases. This can only be equal under special cases. But in most cases, the composition F of G is not always equal to F of G of F is not always equal to F of G. Also, if F maps the set A onto the set B, and G maps the set B onto the set C, and H maps the set C onto the set D, then G, I mean, F of G, then of H is the same as F of G of H. What you're saying is the composition of functions is symmetric. So the composition of functions is, sorry, the composition of functions is associative, but not commutative. So the composition of functions is associative, but not commutative. That's what this remark is trying to tell us. Now, you see, there are at times when you define a set, you define a function on the subset of a given set. There are at times when we define a function on the subset of a given set. So how do we call that function? You see, you have this function f, which is mapped from set A to set B. And then you have this other function g, which is mapped on the subset of set A, which maps the subset of set A onto B. So then, the set g, which is mapping the subset of a set A onto B, we call it the restriction of F to X. So in short, definition number 11, it's saying if F is a function from a set, is a function that maps the set A to the set B, and X is a subset of a set A, then we define, not we deny, we define a new function. Let's define a new function, G, which is mapping the set X onto the set B. You see, here we have F, which is mapping the set A onto the set B. We have the set G, which is mapping the set X, which is a subset of the set A, onto the set B. So we define this function by g of x being equal to f of x for all x. This x for all x which are found in the set X. Then the new function g is called a restriction of f to x. This restriction, we write it as f restricted, this slash, this line represents, you say, F, the restriction of F to X, which is G of X. So the restriction of F to X, which is equal to G. This is how we write it. So what I'm saying, what we're trying to say is, the function G is equal to the function F, which is restricted on X. Okay, let's look at theorem number this remark number 3. So in remark number 3, before we go to theorem number 12, if you look at the restriction of the function and the function itself, the only difference which exists between these two functions, let's just go back. The function f and the restriction of the function, which is g, the only difference which is between these two functions is their domains. The only difference is in their domains. The domain of f is the set A. The domain of the restriction of f is the subset of A. So that's the only difference which is between these two functions. Now, the function f is called an extension of g. So if we start with f, so you can have this function f that you have restricted, which is the function g. So you can get its restriction, which we are calling g. So in short, g, the function g, is the restriction of the function f under x. But if I start with f, f is an extension of the function g. So the function f is called an extension of g if The domain of F contains the domain of G. And if the images under F and G coincide at all points of the domain of G, what do we mean here? So, you have this function, G, let me just go back. This function G, which maps elements of X onto elements of B, we have this function F, which maps elements of A onto elements of B, then we are saying this F, provided this X is the domain, provided this X is a sub, the domain of G is a subset of A, which is the domain of F, and G of X is equal to F of X, then this function G is the restriction of F. Now, when can we call a function to be an extension of G? So this function F is an extension of the function G. If the domain of G, which is this X, is a subset of A, and at every point that you pick in X, any value of X that you pick in the set X, G of X must be equal to F of X. Then you're going to say F is an extension of the function G. Yeah, and you know, when you're talking about extensions, there are a lot of extension of a given function, depending on what set this function has been defined. You can extend the function, there are a lot of them. Yeah, but for the restriction of a given function is usually unique, but the extension of a given function is not unique. Now let's go to theorem number 12. The following theorem gives some basic properties of functions. So this theorem is just illustrating us to us some basic properties that involves the composition of functions. Now let's go to theorem number 12. Let F be a function from a set A to a set B, and G be a function from a set B to a set C. Then, if the function F and the function G are injective, what I mean is they are one-to-one, then their composition will also be one-to-one. If the given two functions are surjective, then their composition will also be surjective. If the given function F and G are both bijective, then their composition will also be bijective. So the proof of this theorem has been left as an exercise. You can find it from different books. Theorem number 13. So we are now looking at some theorems that involves functions. Theorem number 13 says, if the function F, which maps elements of set A to elements of set B, is a bijective function, so in short, is both one-to-one and onto, then there exists a function G that maps the elements of B onto elements of A, such that F of G is equal to the identity of B, and G of F is equal to the identity of A. So what we are saying is, the composition of F with G is to give us an identity of the set B. The composition of the function G with F is to give us an identity of the set A. Now, if this is the scenario, from the look of things, F and G are inverse of each other, which F and G will be the inverse of each other for this to happen. Now, theorem number 14. Let F map element of a set A to a set B, and G map elements of a set B to a set A. Be functions that satisfy the property that the composition of the function F with G is equal to the identity function on B, and the composition of the function G with F is equal to the identity function defined on A, then both F and G are bijective. Then both F and G are bijective. From this theorem, these two theorems, then comes corollary number 15. You can have this consequence of these two theorems, 13 and 14. So what this corollary is saying that, if given a function f that maps elements of set A to set B, there exists a function B, G, which maps the element of set B and set A such that, you see, if we have this function f that maps elements of set A to set B, there exists an element, the function, another function. You have this function that maps elements of set A to set B, and also there, you can also find a function that maps elements of set B to set A, such that the composition of F with G is equal to the identity in B, then G is onto. If instead the composition of F onto G is equal to the identity of B, then G is 1:1. And if both, then F and G are bijective. So this is a connection of theorem number 13 and theorem number 14. But theorem number 16 says the function G, which maps element of a set B to elements of a set A in theorem 13. This function G in theorem 13, this is theorem 13. So this function G, which makes these two properties to hold, is the inverse function of the function F that maps elements of A to set B is unique. So this function is unique and is called the inverse function of a set A. This remark number 4 is just trying to clarify to us on the uniqueness of the function G. On the uniqueness of the function G, so you can look at it at your own time and you can understand it so clearly. Okay, let's now go to theorem number 17, which is proved. Theorem number 17, where we have constructed the proof of the theorem. So theorem number 17 says that if F is a function from a set A to a set B, and you see, if F is a function from a set A and set B, and if the set X is a subset of A and the set Y is a subset of the set B, we are supposed to have a set B here, yeah? Not A, then one, F of the empty set is an empty set. When this function acts on an empty set, what you're going to produce is an empty set. X and Y are subsets of the set A. Is that fine? Two, if this X is a subset of the set Y, of which both of them are subsets of the set A, so then X is a subset of Y, it implies F of X will also be a subset of F of Y. X is a subset of Y implies F of X is a subset of F of Y. Third, F of the union of X and Y, this is equal to the union of F of X and F of Y. Remember, F of X is a set, F of Y is a set, not an element. Secondly, F of the intersection of X and Y is a subset of F of the intersection of F of X and F of Y. So F of the intersection of X and Y is a subset of the intersection of F of X and F of Y. Proof. We start with the first one.
So we are saying, if let's suppose that f of the empty set, when this function f acts on the empty set, the final set that we get is not an empty set. That's what I'm saying. If f of the empty set is not equal to an empty set, if this is the case, then what does this mean? This means there exists a y, an element of f of the empty set. Remember, f of the empty set is a subset of set B, not set A. The subset of set A here is the empty set. Now, f of the empty set is a subset of set B. So now we are saying, if f of the empty set is not equal to an empty set, this means there is a y which belongs to the f of the empty set. Now, if this is the case, what does this mean? So that there exists an element x. You see, f of the empty set is not equal to an empty set. This means there is a y which belongs to f of the empty set. Now, if there is a y that belongs to the f of the empty set, then if this is the case, then this empty set will contain some element x. This empty set will contain some element x such that this y, which belongs to f of the empty set, is equal to f of x. So there is this element x that you can be found in the empty set such that y is equal to f of x, which cannot be possible. This cannot be possible because an empty set does not have any element. There is no such an x which is in the empty set. There is no such an element x which is in the empty set. Therefore, then, because this is contradicting our assumption that f of the empty set is not equal to an empty set, therefore, we conclude that f of the empty set is equal to an empty set. Then we are done. Number two, we want to prove that if x is a subset of y, then f of x is also a subset of f of y. How are we going to start this construction? Let's pick an element x in the set x. Let x be an element of the set x. If x is an element of a set x, then f of x is an element of f of the set x. There is x being an element and capital X here. So if x is an element of x, then f of x is an element of f of capital X. Remember, f of small x is a point. F of capital X is a set. This is a point in set B. F of x is a point in a subset of set B. Whereas f of x is a subset of set B. Now, see, we are saying that let x be an element of x, then f of x is an element of f of capital X. But what does 3 say? Now, since this capital X is a subset, this the set X is a subset of the set Y. You've seen it. This set X is a subset of the set Y. And we have said that there is this element X which is found in the set X. Now, if this X belongs to the set X and which is a subset of the set Y, then this element X is also found in the set Y. Because X is an element of the set X, which is a subset of the set Y, which implies this element X also belongs to the set Y. And so, now, if X belongs to the set X, then f of X is equal to f of capital X. Now, because we have said, and now, since this set X is a subset of the set Y, and the element X is an element of the set Y, then what do we have here? This means f of x will also belong to f of y. So what we have shown is that f of x that belonged to the set f of x, capital X, also belongs to f of y. Hence, this f of x is a subset of f of y. Then you are done with the proof. Next, we need to prove the union. So what we need to show is that, let me just come back. What we need to show is property number three is that f of the union of x, set x and set y, is equal to the union of f of the set x and f of the set y. Now, remember, when we started with sets, we said that to prove that two sets are equal, for example, to prove that set A is equal to set B, we need to show that set A is a subset of set B and set B is a subset of set A. So here, to prove that f of the union of x, set x and set y is equal to the union of f of set x and f of set y, we need to show that the right hand side of this is the subset of the left hand side, and the left hand side of this is the subset of the right hand side. So we need to show that the right hand side is the subset of the left hand side, and the left hand side is the subset of the right hand side. Okay, now how can we do that? You remember when we are proving De Morgan's law, that's the approach we are going to take. Here, we need to involve the inverse of a function and the function. Remember, the composition of the inverse of a function and the function is equal to 1 or is equal to some x. So the composition of a function and its inverse, you get an identity function. So when you compose a function by its inverse, or when you compose the inverse of a function by the function itself, what you're going to get is an identity function. And you know how an identity function behaves. It acts on elements of a given set onto themselves. So now, let's try to see how we can construct this proof. So first, we need to show that f of x intersection, we need to show that f of x union y is a subset of f of x union f of y. Now, how can we start the construction? Remember, f of x intersection y belongs to the set B, not to the set A. So the type of elements that you need to use here are those elements which are found in the set B. Now, so this is now we're starting the proof. Let y, this element y, be an element of f of x union y. F of x union y. If y is an element of f of x union y, then there must be an element that you picked in x union y. If y is an element of f of x union y, remember f of x union y is not an element, it's a set, it's a subset of set B. So if this y belongs to f of x union y, then how did you get this y? That means there was an element x which was found in the union of x and y. So that means there is an element x which belongs to the union of x and y, such that when this function acted on that element, we got the y, such that y is equal to f of x. Now, if x is in x, belongs, if x belongs to x union y, according to the definition of the union, then x is an element of x, or x is an element of capital Y. What does this mean? Back then, you see, x is an element of the set X implies y is equal to f of x. X is an element of the set X implies y, which is equal to f of x. Remember, this x, you picked it in the set x union y, such that this y, which belongs to f of x union y, is equal to f of x. What are we saying then? Then this means But then, x, an element of set x implies y, which is equal to f of x is an element of f of capital X. X from, I think this is coming from property number two, if you use property number two, x is an element of the set x implies y, which is equal to f of x, which is an element of f of capital X. So we are saying f of x is an element of f of capital X, or x is an element of set y implies y, which is equal to f of x, and this f of x is an element of f of set y. So how, we have two scenarios here. We have shown that y is an element of f of x, or the same y is an element of f of y. Now, by the definition of the union, what we have is, we are going to say this y then belongs to the union of f of set x and f of set y. So what have we proved here? We have shown that we picked an element which belongs to f of the union of x and y, and we have discovered that this element y also belongs to the union of f of x and f of y. As such, f of x union y is a subset of f of x union f of y. That is part number one. Next, we prove that the converse inclusion. So we need to prove the converse. We need to show that f of x union f of y is a subset of f of x union f of y. So f of x union f of y is a subset of f of x union y. Now, how can we handle this? We are going to start in the same manner. We are going to do it in the same manner. So let y be an element of f of x union f of y. Then y, if this is the case, by the definition of the union of two sets, this means either y is and belongs to f of x, or y belongs to f of y. Now, you see, if y belongs to f of x, this means there was an element x in the set x such that y is equal to f of x. This means there was an element x in the set x such that y is equal to f of x. Similarly, if y is an element of f of y, then there was an element x that was picked in the set y such that y is equal to f of x. So what we have shown is that y is equal to f of x for an element x that you picked in x, also y is equal to f of x for an element x that you picked in y. Hence, in either cases, when y is equal to f of x, you see here, what you should observe is that you have y, which is an element of f of x, or y, which is an element of f of y. Now, for these two to hold, which means there was an element x in the set x such that y is equal to f of x, there was also an element x in the set y such that y is equal to f of x. Then, if this is the case, this means, if, remember, there is this word I'm using, there exists x in the set x such that this holds, there also exists x in the set y such that y equal to f of x holds. The existence, now if you can check, this x belongs to x, also this x belongs to y. What does this mean? This means x belongs to the union of set x and set y. That's what I'm saying. Hence, in either case, when y is equal to f of x, what does this mean? This means x is an element of x union y. If x is an element of x union y, then y is an element, this y, which is equal to f of x, is an element of f of x union y. As such, what we have shown is that if we pick an element from the set f of x union f of y, this element will also belong to the set f of x union y. As such, the set f of x union f of y is a subset of the set f of x union y. So from equation 1.1 and 1.2, we are going to conclude that f of x union y is equal to f of x union f of y. For the intersection, why is the intersection show inclusion instead of equality? Why is it that the intersection here shows f of x intersection y is not equal to f of x intersection f of y, but instead f of x intersection y is a subset of f of x intersection f of y? We are going to clarify this using a counter example. But before we do that, which is example number 18, but before we do that, let's look at its proof. Before we clarify it, this using a counter example, let's look at its proof. So we are saying that let y be an element of f of x intersection y. So we need to show that f of x intersection y is a subset of f of x intersection f of y. So let y belong to f of x intersection y. Then, if this is the case, then there exists an element x which is in the intersection of x and y, such that this y, which belongs to f of x intersection y, is equal to f of x. Now, if y is equal to f of x, where is this y? Y, which is an element of f of x intersection y. Now, since x is an element of x intersection y implies x is an element of x and x is an element of y, according to the definition of the intersection, what I'm trying to say is that since x belongs to x intersection y, then according to the definition of the intersection of two sets, this implies x is an element of x and x is an element of y. Now, if x is an element of x and x is an element of y, this means that f of x is an element of f of x and f of x is an element of f of y. Remember, I'm using the word and. Therefore, now, if f of x is an element of f of the element x is an element of f of the set x, and f of the element x is an element of this f of the element of the set y, what does this mean? This means f of x belongs to the intersection of these two sets, f of x and f of y. So that is y is an element of f of x intersection f of y. As a result, f of x intersection y is a subset of f of x intersection f of y. Now, the equality in part 4 of this theorem is not true, as shown by the following example. The equality will not hold because of certain conditions that fail. How? Let's look at this example that will clarify this scenario. Okay, let's have a function f from a set A to a set B, which is defined by f of x equal to x squared. Let's look at this quadratic function, f of x is equal to x squared. And let's have the elements x, which belongs to this set of real numbers from negative infinite to infinite. So we need to look at all the real numbers that you can think of: rational numbers, natural numbers, integers, irrational numbers. So this x can be any of those. That's why it belongs to this set. This is a set of real numbers. Let x, this is capital X, be the set of all positive real numbers. And y be the set of all non-positive real numbers. What we are saying is that this set X and set Y are the subsets of this interval, which runs from negative infinite to infinite. In short, we are saying, let this set X and set Y be the subsets of the real numbers. And putting in mind that the kind of elements that set X has are negative real numbers, and the type of elements that set Y has are negative real numbers. So the type of elements that set belongs to set X are positive real numbers, and the type of elements that belongs to set Y are negative real numbers. Then, if you look at these two sets, you see, in set X, we have only positive real numbers. In set Y, we have only negative real numbers. If you intersect these two sets, remember, none of them is containing the number zero. If you intersect these two sets, it will be an empty set. If you intersect these two sets, what you're going to get is an empty set. Now, if what we get is an empty set, then f of x intersection y, which is the same as f of the empty set, is equal to an empty set according to property number 1 of theorem 17. But f of x intersection f of y is not an empty set. The intersection of f of x and f of y is not an empty set. But f of the intersection of x and y is an empty set. Reason being, you see, whatever real number that you pick, positive real number that you pick in x, substitute it into this function, it will give you some positive square, some positive square, to give you a positive square. And whatever negative real number that you pick in the set Y, it will give you again the positive square. So the intersection of the set of positive squares and the intersection of the set of positive squares, you're going to get a set of positive squares. As such, this set is not contained in this set, but this one is contained in this set. What I'm saying is that f of x intersection y is a subset of f of x intersection f of y, but f of x intersection f of y is never a subset of f of x intersection y, according to this example. Now, that property was talking about issues to do with the function. Now, that is theorem number 17. Theorem number 19, we are looking at it from the point of inverse of a function. From the point of inverse of functions. Now, what this theorem is saying that if f maps elements of set A to set B, and if x is a subset of B and y is a subset of B, here now, x and y are subsets of B, not A. Then, f inverse of the empty set is an empty set, and f inverse of B, the set B, is a set A, provided the inverse of this function exists. Secondly, if x is a subset of the set y, then f inverse of the set x is a subset of f inverse of the set y. Secondly, f inverse of x union y is equal to f inverse of x union f inverse of y. So, f inverse of x intersection y is equal to f inverse of x intersection f inverse of y. 2, f inverse of the complement of x, this is equal to the complement of f inverse of x. Let's look at the proofs.
Let's look at the proofs.
The construction of the proof of part 1 of theorem 19 is the same as theorem 17. So if f inverse of theta, remember, let me tell you something here. F inverse of an empty set belongs to A. F inverse of x belongs to A. Also f inverse of y belongs to A. At the beginning, we said, if you look at this theorem, I mentioned to say f of x and f of y belongs to the set B. They are the range of the functions. Now the inverse is the opposite. F inverse of x and f inverse of y belongs to the set A. Even this one, f inverse of x union y belongs to the set A. Even this one, f inverse of x union f inverse of y, all these belong to the set A, not the set B. Okay, now let's now start with the construction of the proof. Now, if f inverse of the empty set is not equal to the empty set, if this is the case, now remember, f inverse of the empty set belongs to x, the set A, then let x be an element of f inverse of the empty set. If x is an element of f inverse of the empty set, then f of x is equal to an empty set. F of x is equal to an empty set, which cannot be possible because this set does not contain any element. As such, f inverse of an empty set is just an empty set. Number two, if the second part of that of part one, the inverse of the function B, the inverse of the function of the set B, the inverse function of the set B is this set containing all the elements x that belongs to the set A, such that f of x belongs to the set B. Now if you look at this set, it's all the elements x that belongs to the set A, such that f of x belongs to the set B. This set is equal to the set A. And this completes the proof. Let's go to part number two of the theorem. Now, this is how we start. We want to prove that if x is a subset of B, if x is a subset of y, then f inverse of x is a subset of f inverse of y. So now, we're going to start like this. Remember, f inverse of x lies in the set A. Now, because this element x belongs to the set A, then you are going to start by saying, let x be an element of f inverse of x. Let x be an element of f inverse of x. Then, to be honest with you, if we take the composition of the function f with respect to its inverse on x, what you're going to get is an x. What do I mean? So then, introducing f inverse both sides, we're going to have f of x will be an element of f inverse of x. Now, f of f inverse of x will be equal to x. So what do we say? Now here, generally, what I'm saying is, let x be an element of f inverse of x, then f of x is an element of x. Where is this x, capital X? This capital X belongs to the set B. Now, since X is a subset of set Y, then F of X is also an element of Y, because F of X is an element of a set X, which is a subset of Y, which implies that this F of X also will belong to the set Y. So, if this is the case, then if I introduce F inverse to both sides, this implies X is an element of F inverse of Y. Hence, x is an element of f inverse of x implies x is an element of f inverse of y. So that, as such, what we have shown is that if x is a subset of y, then f inverse of x is a subset of f inverse of y, which is this one which is written here. Then we are done with the construction of the proof.
The next scenario is
3. What we need to show is, because in 3, we are showing this equality. In 3, so when I do 3, then you can also do 1, because it's the same, I mean, you can do 4, because it's the same concept. So we are going to discuss, I'm going to explain 3, then 4 and 5, we are going to discuss them at some point. Or you can go through them following the ideas of part 3. Now, in 3, we say first, we need to show that F inverse of X union Y is a subset of F inverse of X union F inverse of Y. Now, let X be an element of F inverse of X union Y. If this is the case, then F of X, then if X is an element of F inverse of X union Y, then F of X is an element of X union Y. Now, if F of X is an element of X union Y, according to the definition of a union of two sets, this implies F of X is an element of X, or F of X is an element of Y. Now, F of X is an element of X, or F of X is an element of Y. What does this mean? This means X is an element of F inverse of X, or X is an element of F inverse of Y. Now, X is an element of F inverse of X, or X is an element of F inverse of Y. This implies that X belongs to the union of these two. This means X is an element of F inverse of X union F inverse of Y. What have we shown here? We have shown that an element that belongs to F inverse of X union Y also belongs to F inverse of X union F inverse of Y. Thus, F inverse of X union Y is a subset of F inverse of X union F inverse of Y. Next, we prove the converse. We prove the converse of this theorem. Next, we prove the converse of this theorem. Now, if you look at this X and Y, these two sets belong, they are subsets of X union Y. If you take the union of X and Y, remember, this is a set of all those elements that belongs to set X or set Y or to both. So, if you take the union of X and Y, then X is a subset of the union of X and Y, and Y is also a subset of the union of X and Y. So now, if that is the case, then what we are going to get is this. Since X and Y are subsets of X union Y, then F inverse of X is a subset of F inverse of X union Y. Or F inverse of Y is a subset of F inverse of X union Y. What does this mean? You see, you are saying F inverse of X is a subset of F inverse of X union Y. And also F inverse of Y is a subset of F inverse of X union Y. Where is this coming from? It's coming from the fact that the set X and the set Y, they are subsets of the union of X and Y. Now, if this is the case, according to the union, you see, you are saying this, hence what we have is F of X union F of Y will be a subset of F of X union Y. You have F of X is a subset of F of X union Y, or F of X is a subset of F of X union Y, then F inverse of X is a subset of F inverse of X union Y. Also, F inverse of Y is a subset of F inverse of X union Y. What does this mean? This means F inverse of X union F inverse of Y will be a subset of F inverse of X union Y. Then you have proved the converse. So from equation 1.3 and 1.4, we conclude that these two are equal. So the proofs of 4 and 5 are left as an exercise for you to go through. So now, if you look at the theorems that I've given above, which is theorem 17 and theorem 19, theorem 17 is about the function which is acting on the subsets of the set of the domain, and theorem 19, which gives the inverse function which is acting on the subsets of the range, these two theorems can be extended to any arbitrary collection of sets in the following manner, in the form that I'm about to explain. So, just like the De Morgan's law, can be extended to an arbitrary family of sets. From two sets, you can do the De Morgan's law on more than two sets. So now, even here, these two theorems can also be extended to an arbitrary collection of sets in the following way. This is what we have. So this theorem also is not proved, but you can prove it using the idea that we used under De Morgan's law. You approach it in that same manner. Yes. So now we are saying, let AI, this set I is from an index set I, be a subset of P of X. P of X is the power set of X. And also BJ, J run is an element in the index set J, be also a subset of the power set of Y. So we have this collection. This AI is a collection of sets that belongs to the power set of X, and the BJs is a collection of the sets that belongs to the power set of Y. Then, if the function F acts on the elements of X onto the elements of Y is a function, if this is a function, then F of the union of the AIs, F of the union of the AIs, I is from the index set, this is equal to the union of the F of the AIs. This is the union of F of the AIs, I is in the index set. Secondly, F of the intersection of the AIs, I is in the index set I, this is a subset of the intersection of F of the AIs, I is in the index set I. Thirdly, the F inverse of the union of the BJ, remember BJ belongs to the domain of F. So, F inverse of the union of the BJs, where the J belongs to the index set J, this is the same as the union of F inverse of the BJs, J belongs to the index set J, capital J. Fourthly, F inverse of the intersection of the BJs, J belongs to the index set J, this is equal to the intersection of F inverse of the BJs, where J belongs to the index set J. So, this theorem that you see, this will lead us to the following. This will lead us to this other theorem, which is proved. These are just every, when constructing the proof of theorem number 20, the proofs to theorem number 20, you are going to use the ideas of theorem number 17 and theorem number 19. The same approach that we are taking, now here now, you deal with the sets X and Y, you look at them to be a collection of sets. Then the proof just follows. Okay, now from this proof, then we have this theorem number 21. Let X be a set that maps elements of set A onto set B, and also let this capital X be a subset of A and Y be a subset of B. So we have this function F, which is mapping elements of set A to set elements of set B. And then we also have X a subset of set A and Y a subset of set B. Then, this set X is a subset of the composition of F inverse of F of X. This X, set X, belongs to F inverse of F of X. The set Y is a superset of f of f inverse of a y. The set y is a superset of f inverse of y. What I'm trying to say is that the set x is a subset of the composition of the inverse of a function and the function itself acting on x. And the set y, which is in the domain of f, is a superset of the composition of the function and its inverse on the set y. Let's look at the proofs. We are going to pick an element in the set x, so we are saying let x be an element of the set x. Then by definition, then f of x will be an element of f of x, capital X. F of the element x will be an element of f of the set x. What does this mean? What does this mean? If we take the inverse of the function both sides, what you're going to get is, this implies x is an element of f inverse of f of x. F is an element of f inverse of f of x. This is a capital X. So that now x is a subset, we are supposed to have a subset here. So what happened is, we picked an element x that belongs to the set x, and we have discovered that this element x belongs to f inverse of f of the set x. What does this mean? This means the set x is a subset of f inverse of f of x. Secondly, let y be an element of f inverse of y. Then, if this is the case, then there exists x that belongs to a set A. If y is an element of f inverse of y, then there exists an element x in A such that this f of x is equal to y. Now, if f of x is equal to y, then if f of x is equal to y, and this y belongs to f of f inverse of y, this means the same f of x which is equal to y also belongs to f of f inverse of y, which implies that this x belongs, if I take inverse function both sides, this implies x belongs to, now you see, y belongs to f of f inverse of y, and y is equal to f of x. What does this mean? This means f of x belongs to f of f inverse of y. Now, if f of x belongs to f y, what does this mean? This means this element x belongs to f inverse of y. Now, if this element x belongs to f inverse of y, this means f of x belongs to y. So, with this y, which is equal to f of x, belongs to y. So what we have shown is that we picked an element y that belongs to f of f inverse of y, and we have discovered that this element also belongs to y. As such, f of f inverse of y is a subset of the set y. Okay. These remarks is just about, we are talking about the set of real numbers. So this remark number 6, we are just going to leave it. The example number 22 as well, what this example is asking us to do is that if we have a function f from a set U to a set V, and we have this collection, of sets AI, which are found, which is a subset of the power set of U. So we have this function which maps elements from a set U to a set V, and then we have a collection of subsets of set U, which are the AIs. These are subsets of set U. Then prove that F of the intersection of AI I's in I is a subset of the intersection of F of AI I it belongs to I. I think, and that this containment can be proper. Basically, what we are proving here is the property number 2 in theorem number 20. That's all we are doing there. This is similarly property number 2 of theorem 20. So let's construct the proof. Now, this is how we are going to start with the proof. If this, the arbitrary intersection of the AIs is an empty set, if the intersection of the AIs is an empty set, then F of the intersection of the AIs I's and from the index set I is not defined. In short, will be an empty set, just like in definition, I mean in theorem 17, we said that F of an empty set is an empty set. So if this intersection is an empty set, then F of an empty set is an empty set. That's why we're saying it's not defined. There's nothing to define there. Now, suppose that this intersection is not an empty set, is some set which is different from an empty set. Suppose that N, the intersection of A and I runs from, I is an, in, is an, is from the index set, is not empty. Now, if this is the case, so you say, remember, we want to show that F of the intersection of A, I is from the index set I, is a subset of the intersection of F of AI, I is from the index set. So we are going to start from the right hand side and should come up with the left hand. I mean, we are going to start from the left hand side, should come up with the right hand side. Now, since we are saying this intersection is not empty, then let Y, remember, F of the intersection of AIs is a subset of V. The intersection of the AIs is the one which is a subset of U. So, but the function of the intersection of the AIs is a subset of V. So the type of elements which are found in this set are the Ys which are found in V. So now, let Y be an element of F of the intersection of AI, I runs from I is in the index set. Now, if this is the case, how did you get Y, which is in the in F of the intersection of AI I runs what I is an index is an indexed element? This can only be possible if there is an element X in this intersection. This means there exists an element X which is in the intersection, such that F of that element is equal to Y, such that F of X, this X which belongs to the intersection of the AIs, is equal to Y. Now, you see, since this X belongs to the intersection of the AIs, where I is an indexed set, then for all, this symbol means for all, then for every I that you pick in I, for every I which is an element of the index set I, X is an element of the AI. So what we are saying is, because of the intersection, which this means X, for example, belongs to A1, belongs to A2, belongs to A3, belongs to A4, up to AI. That's what we are saying. For every I in the index set I, this element X will belong to each and every AI. Hence, what do we have? If this is the case, then remember, X belongs to each and every AI. This means F of X is an element of F of AI. This means F of X is an element of F of AI. For every I that belongs to the index set. I'm using the word not for some, for every I that belongs to an index set. For every I, this will mean f of x belongs to the intersection of the f of ai's I is an element in I. What is bringing this intersection? What is bringing this intersection is for every I in I. What we are saying is f of x is an element of f of 1, f of x is an element of f of 2, f of x is an element of f of 3, f of x is an element of up to f of I. So if it belongs to each and every one of these, then this will mean f of x belongs to their intersection. Therefore, we have shown that f of the intersection of ai, I runs from I is an element in the index set I, is a subset of the intersection of the fi's where I is an indexed element. Okay, so now we have the remark number 7. This remark number 7 is just telling us that the equality here will not hold. Equality in example number 22 will not be satisfied. So you can look at it at your own time and see what you can do. Remember, we used the same function, x squared, to clarify that the equality there will not hold. Okay, so this is the end of, let me just say, because we have references here. These references, you can use them to study more on the concepts of functions. And also we have other textbooks that you can go through to look to study functions with different concepts, but the of which you come to realize that the concepts will be the same no matter how many textbooks that you're going to use. So this is the end of lecture number 3. So when we meet next week, we are going to start looking at the real number system on the set of real numbers. We are going to look at its properties that involves real numbers. So this is the end of chapter 1, which is on sets and functions. So next time when we meet again, we'll look at the real number system. Have a lovely afternoon and enjoy your day.